Welcome to another edition of Play It Through, and on this edition it's Castlevania Bloodlines, brought to us by Konami. Castlevania Bloodlines was the only game that was released on the Sega Genesis in the Castlevania series, and it's actually a very interesting game overall as far as the storyline goes. Castlevania Bloodlines is the first of the Castlevania games to really bridge the storylines of Bram Stoker's Dracula and the Castlevania series. It also ties into real-world history, including World War I and the way it was started. The game features Elizabeth Bartley, who is the niece of Dracula, trying to resurrect him. Bartley, based on the real-life Elizabeth Bathory, starts off by conducting a ceremony that basically ends up beginning the start of World War I, causing the death of Franz Ferdinand, allowing her to grab souls from all across Europe. Bloodlines features not one but two main characters from you select from, each having different features. You have John Morris, as well as Eric Lecarde. Morris, a relative of Quincy Morris from the Bram Stoker's novel, uses the vampire killer as his main weapon, while you have Eric, who uses a spear. Each character is playable, and they each have a little bit of difference as far as the level design goes. In this run of the game, I will start off by playing as John Morris on the normal difficulty, unlocking the hardest difficulty, and then replaying the game as Eric. So here we go with Castlevania Bloodlines for the Sega Genesis. After the opening story, we can go to the difficulty where we can select how many lives we start off with, as well as the game level we play on, which we'll be playing on the normal difficulty for our first run, since the hardest difficulty isn't selectable until you beat the game once. Here you can select which of the two characters you want to play as, either Eric or John, and like I said before, we'll be playing as John during our first run. John plays like a traditional Castlevania character, having the whip as his main weapon. Bloodlines also is the first Castlevania game to really feature areas outside of Castlevania itself, starting off in the ruins of Dracula's castle in Romania before traveling across Europe to finally get to actual Castlevania and take out Dracula. While Castlevania Bloodlines may not be as pretty as Super Castlevania on the Super Nintendo, it's still a very good graphical experience for the Sega Genesis. And for the most part, it plays like a typical Castlevania side-scroller, similar to games like Rondo of Blood, for example. While the game doesn't feature any item crashes like Rondo, it does have a good variety of sub-weapons for you to choose from, and each sub-weapon has two attacks. Early on in the game, we pick up a couple of the Eagle Medallions, which levels up our whip a few times, and then overall we pick up some crystals instead of hearts in this game to use our sub-weapons. You can definitely tell that the first level was influenced by the original Castlevania and its first level, as you can just see by the basic design of the stage. One of the other cool things about the game is if you have a fully powered up whip, you can actually get one more power-up to your whip that rarely does appear, and that gets you a flame whip, as well as a very special sub-weapon to use. It pretty much does double damage to all enemies, especially on bosses, so it really helps to have it, but unfortunately you end up losing it anytime you take one hit. You can also lose the special sub-weapon by picking up other sub-weapons. When you get in front of this giant wall of windows, it's time for the first boss battle. This wolf will howl, causing all the windows to start breaking, and the glass can hurt you, Standing in between two columns of the window should help you avoid getting hit by it. Just keep unleashing hits against the wolf and he'll go down rather quickly. Once his full health is depleted though, he becomes a pile of mess on the ground and you'll have to hit him one more time to get rid of him. In the next room, watch out for the skeletons as you work your way up the stairs and then break down the right wall in case you've lost some health to pick up a health item. The blood and gore in Bloodlines was also brought up a little bit. I mean, you have half a body chained up on the ceiling, still dripping blood on you below. Be careful of the dragon skeleton to the right here. Use your whip by ducking down so you can both hit the fireball as well as the head, and you won't end up getting hit by the fireballs being shot from the top ones. Typical Castlevania enemy that we've pretty much seen in every game that's ever come out for the series. Up here, take out the skeleton that tries to jump at you, and use your long distance of your whip so that when they put out their sword, they won't be able to hit you with it. Here we end up getting another upgrade to our whip, and now we have that weird flame whip that I mentioned earlier. As you can see, it's going to do a pretty good amount of damage, and enemies that would take maybe 2-3 hits are going to be taken out in maybe one. Over here, watch out for the giant guillotine swinging back and forth. Jump over it after it swings a few times so that the momentum gives you enough time that when you get onto the opposite side of it, you can outrun it. On the next screen, just quickly work your way up the giant skeleton spine here so that you can make it up before the piece breaks and causes you to fall down into the pit. Here we have our first dragon skeleton that's actually the long version. I like to hit him every time he comes forward and you'll be able to bounce him back towards the wall that he's attached to. Do this a few times and you'll be able to hit him before he's ever able to get out any of the fireballs. When you make it to the top of the stairs, you can collect some extra items from the candles before we face the boss of this level. The axe armor will come at you from the right side. Use your sub-weapon to hit it from a distance, and when it gets in range of your whip, start immediately attacking it. If you keep attacking it from a distance, you should be able to knock off some of its parts before it's ever able to get close to you. It has all kinds of different moves depending upon which of its weapons it's using. Don't worry, since we're going to be playing the game twice, you'll get to see some more of its moves the second time around because he's definitely tougher then. After you beat him, you can grab the gem and complete stage number one. Level 2 is probably my favorite level in the game. The Atlantis Shrines over in Greece. It also has probably one of the more famous songs from this game. The Minotaur bulls will try to attack you, but you can easily hit them when they land on their feet from their big jump when they try to get close to you. Later on in the area, you will have some fish creatures try to jump at you, but they're pretty easy, take one hit to take out. Just be careful when you're making your platforming that you don't accidentally fall down below. In the next segment, the water starts rising from below and then the screen starts scrolling upwards, so you'll have to work your way up staircases and different jumps in order to make it up before the water ends up engulfing you and causing you to lose a life. Since it's really hard on your first time to see when an enemy's gonna appear above you on a platform while you're working your way up the stairs leading to it, just move up slowly and wait for the screen to scroll up just so you can at least see their feet before you attempt to go all the way up the stairs. Thankfully, the Minotaurs, while they have a pretty long range of their weapon, they hesitate a few seconds before they actually attack you with it. And of course, that's a great opportunity to get in there and unleash some hits to take them out before they're ever able to attack you. Up here, we have an actual series of mini-bosses. The first one is this wizard who summons water that actually keep building up on the bottom and can cause you to drown. Every time you hit him on one side of the screen, he teleports to the other, so just keep jumping back and forth and hitting him each time, and you should be able to easily take him out before the water gets too high. Over here, I recommend using a sub-weapon to take out the two crows before we fight the next mini-boss. This soldier is actually really easy, just stand really close to him and start attacking. When he unleashes his attack of his giant mace, it'll go right over your head and you can keep hitting him over and over again. Just be careful not to get hit by the mace or hit by him when he jumps. For the second guy, hit him a couple of times and then back away so that when he uses his giant axe, it won't be able to hit you. If you're lucky, you may be able to defeat him before he ever gets on screen fully. Then once he's done, walk over to the right and go down the staircase. Jump on the rafts below and now the water will start decreasing and you'll have to ride the rafts downwards. Be careful not to fall down onto the platform below when there's actual water there still, and be sure not to get hit by the Medusa heads while you're trying to do so. Grab some extra items on your way down and just keep jumping back and forth between the rafts whenever you see a platform directly below you that you know you'll end up getting caught on when the rafts continue down. In this next segment, you have these guys with maces that'll block your attacks. Just keep attacking them, and after a few blocks, they'll still go down. However, if they try to do a jump attack from a higher platform, you have a great opening to hit them directly, and you'll pretty much take them out with one hit. Watch out for the dragon skeleton here, and then break off the column so that it causes a platform to appear so you can jump on it. Over here, we'll once again break down the column so that we can jump on its platform and continue on. On this last one though, it will start to sink as soon as you break it, so you'll have to quickly run across it to make it across. On the next screen, don't go down the stairs too fast or drop down to the platform below while the water is still lower. Then it's time for the next actual boss fight. Here we're going to be using our special move in order to break apart the middle part of this giant golem so that we can end up hitting the eye on the top part of it. You can't actually hurt the golem except on his head. Use your whip to break apart all the rocks until he's low enough that when you jump, you'll be actually able to hit him. His main attack is he'll punch the ceiling causing rocks to fall down, which shouldn't be too much of a threat to you. When you've broken apart his body that he's too low to punch the ceiling, he will jump up in the air instead and cause an earthquake. Once you destroy the crystal on his head though, he's defeated and you can move on to stage number 3. Stage number 3 is probably the coolest designed level of the entire game, the Leaning Tower of Pisa. You start off with these harpies trying to attack you with spears, and they take two hits to beat. One to knock the spear out of their hand, and then one more to actually defeat them. Also in this segment, the minotaurs are back, and they're actually breaking columns from the foreground and trying to hit you with them. So just stand far enough away that your whip can reach them, and that the column isn't close enough to you to actually hit you when it swings. Walk up these stairs very quickly so you can avoid all the fireballs, then take out the peeping eye at the top before moving on to the next screen. This room is full of those banshee harpies, so just keep attacking them while you make your way up the first slope
and then jump onto the next section. In this room, you'll have to use your whip to swing so you can make it over the gap to where the mummy is. These mummies take a few hits to kill, so be careful and stay on the platform below them before jumping up to them. Then, you another swing across the gap so you can make it onto the next screen. Here we have our first mini-boss of the level. This skeleton dragon will try to attack you, but every time it comes out of the wall, just jump up and attack it, causing it to go back. You can also use your sub-weapons in an effective way to get rid of it. Just be sure to stay low to the ground so when it uses its giant flame, it doesn't end up hitting you. This is probably the coolest segment of the stage. You're actually in the tower itself as it's leaning back and forth. You have to work your way up the different platforms while also dealing with Medusa heads coming at you from both the left and right sides. While overall it's not a terribly difficult segment to deal with, it still ends up being probably one of the better experiences and most memorable ones from the game. When you reach the top of the tower, you'll move on to the next part of the level. Watch out for the mummies here because they can throw out their wrapping a pretty far distance. Just destroy it with your whip as it gets close to you. Watch out from these bats that are going to come at you from both sides before climbing up the stairs to the next segment. During this segment of the level, you'll have to move up all these moving platforms. Keep jumping between them while watching out for the skeletons that are going to try to attack you. The skeletons circle around the screen once or twice before they finally get close enough for you to actually easily hit them. After a while, you'll switch from moving diagonally to moving straight up and down. Just stay in about the center platforms as they are consistent going upwards, and also worry about taking out their skeletons from the left and right side again. Thankfully, during this segment, they're a lot easier to hit since the screen segment is actually a little bit smaller and you can move closer to them. Eventually, you'll start seeing some platforms on the far right side going diagonal again. Your screen will start scrolling that way, so you'll have to continue jumping up on the platforms to the right now. When you make it to the top, collect some items before moving to the next screen where it's time for the next boss fight. You'll battle this giant red gargoyle on the very top of the tower itself. You can attack him on the left side when he tries to do a tail whip because your whip will be able to hit him from mid-range and his tail can only go to the edge of the tower itself. After you hit him twice or three times, he'll then go to the opposite side and do the same thing. Hit him a few times while he's up in the air and you'll cause him to fall back down again. When he does this, he'll fly back up and now start bouncing around the top of the tower itself. Just try to avoid getting hit by him as he bounces and deliver the final few hits you need to get rid of him. The fourth level of the game takes place in a munitions factory in Germany, so there's a little bit of a military feel to this level. As you can see, the skeletons all have helmets on. During the opening segment, you have skeletons that are going to pop out of the barrels to throw at you, as well as skeletons behind the fence that are going to jump forward over that fence to try to get you. Once you're inside the factory, I suggest doing a big upwards diagonal hit with your whip to take out the skeleton above before climbing up the stairs. You have two types of the skeletons during this segment. You have ones that will break apart to just their head and then reform one more time, and ones with shields that you'll knock the sword out and then knock out the shield. Here, wait for the guy to get done swinging his mace and then drop down the right side of the conveyor belt to easily move on to the next screen. Be careful of the skeletons hitting them as you make your way across these conveyor belts, and be sure not to accidentally fall down below. In the next room, it's full of pistons that are going to try to squash you, so wait for the right opportunity when it's retracting so you can start working your way up the platforms. Most move slow, but then you'll start seeing ones move faster and faster. Thankfully, the top one, which moves the fastest, doesn't have a wall that it can really squash you against. The next room has a giant middle gear, so jump on it and then ride it across to the upper right, and then start climbing up the stairs. Here we have a skeleton that when you hit him, he'll break apart to the ground and then disappear. It looks like he's gonna reform himself like the red skeletons from other Castlevanias, but he just disappears. The only real difficult part about this whole thing is of course watching out for those flying Medusa heads, which have pretty much become commonplace in this game so far. Up at the top, jump onto the gear so you can make it up to the upper left and climb up the stairs to the next segment. Here we have a counterbalance system, when we jump on one platform the other one rises, and you'll have to do this to make your way all the way across. At the end, you'll have to stay on the platform for a few seconds so that the other part rises up so you can make it to the next screen. Here we fight a giant Frankenstein monster. After his first attack, get in close and duck down in front of him. His next attack will cause him to do a chain all the way out straight, which you usually duck, and then for his third attack, he'll punch the ground causing a flame to ripple. Just jump over it and continue attacking him. In the next segment, you have some spinning blades that you'll have to get into the groove of the opening on them, so you can make it through without getting hit by the blade. After the first blade, take out the enemies, and then move on to the second one, going quickly through because it moves a lot faster. The third and final one's a lot harder since it spins in the opposite direction. So what you'll have to do is in the opening, walk a couple of steps, then duck back down, and keep doing that until you're able to get all the way through it. In the next segment, you'll have to jump on these platforms between the gears as they move around. Be careful when you jump on one of these platforms that you don't jump up in the range of the guys with the mace. Try to do your best to hit them from a distance before jumping to the next platform. After that, you have a small room filled with gears. Just run over to the right, killing them if you like while picking up some items before you get ready for the next boss battle. Here we have the gear steamer. This giant mess of gears, you'll have to hit the center of him in order to do damage, and as you can see, that globe in the center, every time you hit it, he'll end up flashing. Also, when you hit it, he'll get smaller and smaller, eventually regrowing full size when he gets low on health. For the most part, he's a pretty simple battle, jumping over him when he tries to go across the ground and ducking underneath of him when he goes above. When he throws out some gears, try to do your best to avoid them and unleashing as many hits as you can. Once you deplete all his health, he'll explode and we can move on to stage number 5. Stage number 5 is the Versailles Palace in France. It starts off in this forest-filled area. Walk over to the right and then destroy this giant rose on the top part. The pollen that comes out of the rose will actually flip your controls, causing left to go right and right to go left. Either jump onto the platform or just try to do your best to walk in between the pollen as it falls down from the other roses. If you get hit, just switch up your controls for a few seconds until you stop flashing. When you make it inside the giant fountain, eventually it'll turn blood red and some red skeletons will start to attack. Remember, these skeletons can actually reform after you hit them, so hit them once and then walk past them. Eventually, you'll have a large group probably following you from behind. These enemies are a little bit unpredictable in their movements as they swing back and forth with a large blade. They hit a huge distance, and it's best to probably hit them with one of your sub-weapons from afar before actually getting in close. Here, though, we can stand on this root just to the left of him and be able to hit him as he swings. Next up, we're inside the actual palace here. Watch the ceiling as you'll see chandeliers on the top and they'll fall immediately as soon as you get near them. There's some large enemies in here, but if a chandelier falls on them, they'll instantly be defeated. They take a good amount of hits to take out, and they throw a large axe at you, just like axe armors from previous Castlevania games. Duck the axe if they throw it straight, or if they duck and throw the axe, be sure to jump over it and continue unleashing hits on them. They take about 7 or so hits to actually defeat them. This guy at the end of the area with the large sword takes a lot of hits, and I recommend using your special sub-weapons to hit him from afar before he ends up trying to slash you with his sword. In the next room, take out the giant tower of skeleton dragons by ducking down in front of it and just keep swinging the whip. In the next room, watch out for the laser eyeballs as you just walk across the room to the right. Here you'll enter another room full with barrels. Do another one of those swings with your whip so that you can make it across the gap. Then take out the guy throwing bombs. Just stay close to him as all the bombs will just be thrown right over your head every time you fight this guy. In the next room, work your way up the spinning tower, jumping up all the things as it moves around. Also, watch out for the skeletons as well as the skeleton dragon spitting fireballs on the platforms. In the next room, you'll take on another one of those giant soldiers like we did in the second level. Get near him and duck in front and keep hitting him with your whip. If you duck right in front of him and just stay a little bit away from his knee when he ducks down to hit you, he'll end up missing you and just go over you every time. The next room, start battling these guys shooting arrows. Do your best to avoid them as they shoot them upwards and they do an arcing shot right towards wherever you're standing. This hammer guy moves pretty slowly, and his hammer can only hit a little bit in front of him when he tries to swing it, so your whip should be able to outreach it. After a while of not having it, we get the other upgrade to our whip again. Duck on this platform to hit this guy on wheels as he tries to keep getting closer to you. Then duck underneath this guy with the machine gun fire and hit him a few times with your whips to get rid of him. It's now time for another boss battle. This boss is definitely unique, as you actually can't hurt it when it's actually attacking you. Try to do your best to avoid the shots that it shoots out. You can destroy the projectiles, but it can be a little bit hard to do so sometimes. When the room is lit up and the columns in the center of the room, you can then actually hit it to do damage to the boss. When it's firing out your projectiles, either try to use one of your sub-weapons to hit them, or stand just a little bit away from them so that when they come down at you, you can at least destroy 2 and maybe 3 of them. Once it's taken care of, we move on to the next segment. Walk down the stairs picking up some extra items before we get ready for the real boss battle of stage number 5. The boss for the stage is the Princess of Moss, and she starts off looking rather easy. She floats downwards and you just have to keep attacking her a few times, and then she'll eventually transform into a giant moth. When she does this, she'll fly across the top of the screen causing pollen to fall down. Do your best to avoid it as the pollen does the same thing it did earlier in the level. Thankfully, with John being able to hit diagonally with his whip, you can do a good amount of damage while it's flying overhead. Watch out for it as it tries to attack you by flying down towards you by just walking the opposite direction of it. Keep delivering hits and you'll burn it up and be able to move on to the final level of the game. The final level of the game takes place in the Castle Proserpina in England. On the opening segment, watch out for the crows as well as the Medusa heads that actually can fire projectiles as you work your way across this bridge. Either jump over the projectiles or just duck underneath of them when they're fired at you. But keep moving to the right, eventually the bridge will break and you'll have to jump onto the last segment to continue on. In this next segment, you have this weird room that's broken up into three different segments. Focus on whatever segment you can really see, and remember, wherever the platform is, you have to have that part of your body on it. So if the platform's in the middle of the screen, make sure that you're aiming towards that middle part with your character. It's definitely confusing, but once you do this once or twice, you'll have no problem continuing to get through. The next segment has you upside down, walking on the ceiling, so the controls here are a little bit different as well as you attack enemies. Just be careful not to accidentally fall through the pits, which is actually the ceiling during this stage. Jump along the platforms, doing your best to watch out for the glowing orbs, and use the staircases instead of jumping, because it can be a little bit tricky to make those jumps. This room, while filled with items for you to collect, also has those armor knights that we fought as the first boss of the game. You'll have to listen up because you can actually hear them getting closer to you, so you'll have to be able to time your hit correctly as some move faster while some move slower. Thankfully though, they're not like the real boss and they only take one hit to kill. After the segment, you'll come to a large staircase. Climb up and get ready for the boss gauntlet that starts off with an old familiar friend of the Castlevania series, Death. The battle against Death is broken up into two parts. The first part has cards circling around them. You attack a card in order to activate it. Three of them contain rematches against previous bosses. After hitting the first card, I have a rematch against Gear Steamer. These matchups end up being a little bit easier and you seem to do more damage to the boss than you did the first time around. However, the strategy is going to pretty much remain the same. Once you defeat the boss, you'll come back out to Death and have to pick another card. Here we end up fighting against the gargoyle for a second time. We'll once again be on the top of the tower and have to battle him. Attack him on the left side when he tries to do his tail whip just like before, and you'll see you'll do a ton of damage this time around. Repeat the process when the gargoyle tries to do the same on the right side of the screen. Then he'll start bouncing around the top of the tower just like he did before. Watch out so you don't end up getting hit by him here, and just deliver the final few hits. Other than the boss battles, Death has three other cards, one that gives you a ton of extra health, and two of which will have him fire a fireball at you. Stay on the left side of the screen, and when it builds up, just get ready to jump over it as he throws it out towards the ground. We have only one card left to choose from, and that's the rematch against the Golem from stage number 2. Unfortunately, you start on the ground when you fight the Golem this time around, so keep jumping up and attacking the middle part of his body so you can break him down so you can eventually do damage to him. Watch out for all the falling rocks, just like we did before, while delivering all the hits you can. It'll only take about 3 or 4 hits to actually destroy the crystal this time around. But once he's done so, get ready for the actual boss fight against Death himself. When Death used all his cards, they'll come back to him, and now he'll actually start flying around the room firing his sickles at you. With John, we can use our diagonal whip to hit him while he's in the air, and then jump over him when he tries to do the sweeping hit with his sickle on the ground. He'll then fly to the left or right side of the screen, trying to pull you towards him when he throws out his sickle. Just be sure to jump over the sickle as it comes in close to him and keep hitting him as much as you can. After the boss fight with Death, we climb up another staircase, and we get ready for our boss battle against Elizabeth Bartley. The first part in the battle against Bartley will have her summon Medusa to fight you. Stand next to Medusa just at the end of her hand. If you do so, her first attack will just go over you. Then, duck underneath her second attack that's a giant flamethrower, jump over her tail whip, and then start backing away from her and hitting her every time she inches closer. After a few seconds of this, get close again so you can dodge that first attack and stay underneath of the flamethrower move. If you're lucky, you should be able to defeat her before she's able to get through her second cycle of attacks. Once she's done though, it's time to actually fight Bartley. She starts off by summoning 4 spheres in the center of the screen. What you have to do is when she goes to the opposite side of the screen from you, you have to hit her in order to get rid of one of these spheres. You have to keep hitting her and destroy all the spheres before they join together, in which case then they'll unleash an attack against you. After you destroy all 4, you'll actually see damage done to her, and then she'll go back to the center and summon a new set of spheres. The second set obviously has fire within inside of them. Just keep moving back and forth and attacking Elizabeth as much as you can, and after you destroy all the spheres, she'll once again go back to the center. This time, however, she's gonna summon 5 spheres, so you have to hit her 5 times instead of 4. For her final set, she'll summon 6 spheres, so you'll have to be really quick in order to keep hitting her, and you really can't miss during this segment. Once you've taken care of all the sword spheres, she'll go back to the middle and summon her first attack again. Just hit her one last set of 4, and you'll actually defeat Bartley, and we can move on to the final boss of the game. The final room before Dracula himself has a long corridor where you can collect some extra items. Don't worry, there's no enemies during this part. You then climb up the staircase in order to meet Dracula once and for all. You can see Dracula's coffin in the background, and then a beam of light will come down and summon him. The first part of the battle against Dracula is pretty common. He'll appear and then fire 3 fireballs at you, which can be destroyed or jumped over. The best way is to stand a good distance away from him and just time your hit so you destroy the fireballs as soon as they're summoned. Just be sure not to be standing where the light summons them. Once you defeat the first form, he'll go to the center and turn into this weird magician. He'll then go back to the center and turn into this weird mage-type character. Use Morris's ability to do the diagonal whips in order to actually hit him. Every time you hit him, you'll do a significant amount of damage. Watch out for the fireballs he summons and jump over him when they form together in the center. He'll then split into 5 and cause 4 beams of light to come down. Either stand under the real form of him, or stand in between the 2 beams to dodge him. Once he's defeated, he'll turn into a giant demon for the final fight of the game. For this fight, jump up and attack him with your whip. Then get him stuck in the corner and you can keep hitting him over and over again with your diagonal move. Watch out for the sickles he throws out, and eventually he'll turn red. When he does this, he'll summon an arcing shot of fire. Jump over it and attack him every time you do so, in order to keep avoiding getting hit while also dealing a good amount of damage. After a few hits here, he'll turn all white, and every hit you hit him here will cause bones to break apart from him. Watch out because the bones can hurt you, but all he's going to do is keep jumping around the room. Deliver all the hits until he's fully defeated, and you can sit back and enjoy the ending. While one of my favorite songs from the game plays in the background, we now get the first set of credits we're going to see during the course of this video. You also get a roll call of all the bosses you fought during the game. While Bloodlines may not be that difficult of a Castlevania game overall, just the graphics and especially the music makes it one of the better experiences of the Castlevania games during the 16-bit era. And I still feel that this game ended up being better than the butchered port of Rondo of Blood that was put on the Super Nintendo as Dracula X. While the port of Dracula X would come out later, this was the final new experience on consoles until Symphony of the Night was released and reinvented the whole series. At the copyright screen, you'll then see it say at the bottom, try expert mode, and then it'll go back to the main menu of the game. Once you press start at the main menu, go down to options and you'll see that expert mode is now selected. And just for some added difficulty, I'll also switch down the lives to just one left. Then select start, and this time around I'm going to be picking Eric, who ends up being probably my favorite of the two characters to play as we now go through the game again on expert difficulty. And we start off, of course, in the ruins of Castle Dracula in Romania. Eric controls a lot differently than John, mainly due to the fact that he can charge up his jump by ducking down, similar to characters in Super Mario 2, as well as his spear has a little bit different movement. Eric can attack straight up with the spear, and when he does so, if you press left and right while it's still up, you can cause it to swing left and right and hit enemies on the side of you. For the second playthrough, I'm going to try to go through the level as quick as I can, and showcase the differences between John and Eric. Overall though, the difficulty, while tougher, mainly means that there is more enemies. For example, right here, instead of one peeping eye, you have two, as well as enemies that normally attack slow will definitely be attacking much faster. The main example I can give for that one is definitely the guys who throw the maces around by swinging them over their heads. Those guys move so quickly, it can be hard sometimes to get in and actually deliver hits to them. For the most part, the stage layouts are pretty much the same, except Eric can go into a couple areas that John couldn't, mainly those areas involving the swinging that John had to do in certain rooms to get over pits. Since Eric can't do that, Eric has to go to other ways. Here we have a rematch against the wolf, which you can see is easily taken down with my now flaming spear that I got from my ultimate upgrade. And then I move on to the next room of the castle. Once again, watch out for the skeletons. This time there's also a bat to deal with, and you can see the skeletons get off the ground a little bit quicker. If you need some extra health, once again, break down that right wall. Watch out for the skeletons that are gonna leap from the platforms as you make your way up here, and then get over to where the dragon statue is, and then beat it down with your spear. Take out the skeleton from the stairs, and then you can actually use Eric's special jump in order to get up to higher platforms. You can actually go through a lot of the platforms of the game. Once again, in this room, be careful of the giant swinging guillotine in the middle. And of course, watch as the one skeleton always seems to jump to his doom by jumping into the blade itself. There was an example of one of those spinning mace guys spinning about 3 times as fast as he did on the normal difficulty. Once again, climb up the dinosaur spine, and then take out the skeleton dragon attached to the platform before we get ready for the first boss battle of the game. He's gonna be a little bit faster this time, and he likes to jump a lot more than he did on the first time around. As you can see, his movements are definitely sped up. Try to do your best to attack him. If he goes for a spear stab, be sure to duck away from him, but not close enough that he can actually hit you when he spins it around his legs. Stay at a far distance away from him so that when he does his kick move later on in the battle, that it easily misses you just by an inch or two. Once he goes down, we can grab the jewel and move on to stage number 2.
Once again, one of my favorite Castlevania songs here in Stage 2, the Atlantis Shrine in Greece. The Minotaur guys jump a little bit faster, but our powered-up weapon can still hit them from a good distance away, causing them to die before they're ever able to get close enough to us. Once again, during this segment, we have to be careful that the water doesn't engulf us and cause us to lose a life, as we work our way up the staircases and platforms to the top. There are a few more enemies during this segment, so be careful while going up this time. Once again, we're taking our time up here, waiting for enemies to attack from platforms above before we try to get in close to them, and then actually take them out with our spear. Over here, you wouldn't be able to actually make it up using John, but with Eric, we can actually do a big jump in order to make it to the platform above without going to the left staircase. Once up here, we have our rematch against the sorcerer who summoned the water. Just keep jumping back and forth to the left and right attacking, and you'll be able to easily deplete all his health before the water even gets close to you. Watch out for a couple of crows, which you actually can hit by doing a nicely timed jump attack, and then face off with the soldier again. Duck in front of him, just keep popping him in the kneecap, and just back away when he does his big jump. His mace is always going to go over you and you can easily take him out. For the axe guy, hit him once or twice and then immediately back away so that when he swings down the axe, they won't be able to make contact with you. Keep repeating this until you take away all his health, just be sure to back away in case he actually gets a jump off. When he does his jump attack, his axe gets stuck in the ground, and this is another great opportunity just to deplete all his health. During this segment, the Medusa heads pretty much move at the same speed as they did during the normal difficulty, so there isn't too much change in this segment. The biggest trouble is, of course, just accidentally falling down and end up losing a life by falling into the water. During this segment, we once again attack the mace guys as soon as they make their jumping attack towards us, and if they do block us, just keep hitting them, and you'll be able to get a hit on them, killing them before they're able to attack you. Break the head off the statue and continue on moving through the platforms. Just be careful of the skeleton dragon here before you jump to the platform you broke apart. Just be careful on the last platform that you move quick enough so it doesn't accidentally cause you to lose a life by it sinking. Duck down here and take out the skeleton dragon before going down the stairs. Down here, just be careful of all the minotaurs running back and forth before you go down the staircase for the boss battle against the golem. Since I have Eric's special weapon, I'm just going to use this right at the top of the raft here, and you'll see I'll be able to actually kill this boss before I actually sink all the way down to the bottom.
If you defeat the top part of him before you destroy all the body still stays there and just takes a couple extra seconds, I think, maybe for his entire body to destroy itself, before you can end up grabbing that jewel and move on to stage number 3. Even with the most powerful weapon, it still takes 2 hits to take out the harpies that fly above with the spear. Watch out for the minotaurs once again when they swing the columns at you when they break them apart from the foreground. Just like the first time, move quickly up the staircase and you'll be able to avoid all the fireballs. Just take out the peeping eye at the top so you can get over to the right and make it to the next screen. Here comes our first difference. Instead of going right to the next section, continue using Eric's special jump to jump all the way to the top during here. Then, once up here, I recommend doing one of your big special moves or using your sub-weapon to try to take out a good amount of the harpies before you continue on to the right and go on to the next section. Instead of doing the room with the barrels in the background, you instead go right to the battle against the dragon skeleton. Just like before, we're going to be attacking him, but you can actually use a diagonal hit from Eric to hit him from the ground level without actually jumping up towards him. Next up is the very fun leaning tower portion of the stage, where you work your way up the platforms while dodging the Medusa heads on the left and right sides. There isn't any difference to this section, so just take your time while working up these platforms. You can even use Eric's special jump from time to time to bypass some of the platforms. Once at the top, we enter the room where the mummies are located. Just stay a good distance away from them and hit them when they try to swing their wrap at you. This segment isn't changed either, as you make your way up the diagonal platforms while occasionally jumping back in order to take out the skeletons that appear from behind. Once the tower in the background reaches the center of the screen, focus your attention on going upwards, especially on the middle set of platforms as they're the easiest to travel up. Just keep working your way up the center until, of course, the platforms appear to the right, and then start jumping in that direction. Thankfully, the skeletons during this segment really aren't capable of hitting you while you're jumping forward onto these platforms, so you really don't have to worry about being knocked down into the pits or gaps in between the platforms. When we reach the top, we have a small segment before we end up facing off with the gargoyle again. The attack him on the left side when he does his tail whip, just be sure to back away a step or two from the edge so that tail whip doesn't hit you. And then when he has his actual tail out, he'll fire out some rocks at you from the tip of his tail. But if you're right next to him, you should be able to easily jump in between the top two rocks and continue hitting him until you knock him down. When you knock him down, he'll go to the opposite side and do the same amount of attacks. Just like always though, when you knock him down here though, he's gonna start bouncing around the top of that tower, so keep delivering your final few hits to take him out, and then collect the jewel at the end. And just for a little added bonus, I like to do the special jump right at the end to finish him off that final hit. Now we're back to level 4 of the munitions factory in Germany. Just like the previous level, the skeletons here are definitely gonna move faster and try to attack you a little bit more than they did the first time around. Though honestly, there isn't too much difference, and just continue moving to the right and dodging a few bones from the background, you should be able to get through the segment. The skeletons that break apart and you have to hit them again once they reform definitely reform a little bit faster this time. Remember, the mace throwing guy down here will keep swinging really fast, so wait for the right timing for him to stop before you try to drop down and go through the opening to the right. Remember at any point that if you have the special spear already leveled up, but you lose your special sub-weapon, if you pick up two of the same weapon, you'll be able to get the special weapon back. So if you have an axe already and you pick up another axe, you'll go to the special one. But that only works if you currently have the fire spear, or fire whip in case you're jumping. Work your way up the piston room, you can even use Eric's special jump to get up there a little bit quicker. While Bloodlines is more of a side story, it features a lot of key things. Like already mentioned before, it has connections to the Bram Stoker novel, as well as it introduces us to the Alucard Spear, a special weapon that Alucard handed down to the Lecarde family and they passed along themselves, just like the Belmonts had been passing down the Vampire Killer. However, the Belmonts would give the Vampire Killer over to the Mortis family and they were unable to use its full power. Thus, with the power along with the Alucard Spear, the Mortis family would gain the ability to use its full power, thus being able to take out Dracula. That's the reason that John and Eric really kind of have to work together in order to take out Dracula during the course of Bloodlines. Other than that, Eric does have his own personal reasons for getting involved. Mainly, his girlfriend Gwendolyn was turned into a vampire by Elizabeth Bartley, and thus, he didn't have the ability to change her back using magic, so he is trying to get revenge for it. Over here, we face off with the Frankenstein monster once again, getting close to him after he does a spin attack, so that the next attack goes over your head, and then jump over the flame attack he throws into the ground. The next room, once again, be very careful while going through the giant spinning blade that you don't accidentally hit your head on it. Though it's definitely interesting that the blade can hurt you when you do your special jump into it. Take out the enemies before you try to go through the faster blade that's the second one, and then of course be very careful while going through the third and final blade. During this segment, like before, we're going to be using our sub-weapons in order to take out the skeletons with the spinning maces before we try to jump to their platforms, since they can hit a lot farther distance and really fast now with the faster moving mace. Move through the room with all the gears, and then it's time to battle Gear Steamer once again. Immediately start attacking him when you get the opportunity, attacking him in his center core, in order to do a good amount of damage. He'll jump to the opposite side so you can continue hitting him. He'll do a spin kick above you, however, if he's too small, he won't be able to hit you even while you're standing. And then he does his move where he goes across the ground, which you can easily jump over. Once you do enough damage, he grows big once again and does a big jump into the center of the room. Just keep attacking him and watch out for the gears that he throws out when his arms start spinning. Once we deliver the final two hits, he ends up breaking apart and we can collect the jewel and move on to stage number 5. So now we're back in stage number 5, the Palace of Versailles, located in France. Try to do your best to watch out for the roses above you as they drop their pollen, either by destroying them or just trying to walk quickly past them. When you make it over to the fountain again, be sure to watch out for the skeletons that form. You'll have to hit them and then they'll reform after a few seconds and start chasing you down. Unlike most enemies, they don't seem to move much faster, so they really aren't too much of a threat. Over here, we have my least favorite enemy probably in the whole game, because they're really hard to judge exactly where they're going to be swinging. The amount of their swing and the speed of their swing changes each and every time you come through this area, and it's really just completely random how they're going to attack. Stay as far away from them as you can, and just deliver a few hits now and then in order to actually hit them. There I was showcasing a little bit of how Eric can spin his spear to the left and right to take out enemies on his side a little bit easier when they're trying to attack you. In the next room, be sure to use the chandeliers on the ceiling to your advantage to take out some of the armor knights that are going to try to throw their axes at you. The guys with the swords are probably the worst enemies in this area. Be sure to use your special sub-weapon if you have it, or try to do your best to attack from a distance to take those guys out. In here, use your special weapon or duck down in front of it to take out all the skeleton dragons while they shoot out their fireballs. In here, we won't be able to go to the right, so we have to jump up using Eric's special jump in order to make it through the giant room with all the laser eyes. Just be careful of any of the lasers that come straight at you, and then jump over to the far right so you can make it into the next section of the stage, which as you can see, is kind of on top of the palace itself. Here we have some harpies that we saw in the previous levels, however they drop these little flea guys on you as well, just like the flea men from previous Castlevania games. These guys can be a little bit annoying. So just try to do your best to either outrun them or use your sub-weapon as they come up from behind, or try to take out the harpy in the air before they're able to drop off the guy. You'll enter back into the top of the spinning tower room like we did with John. Instead of going up though, we go down. Just try to do your best to watch out for the skeleton dragons as you do so and go through the first opening on the right to take out the giant blue guy again. Duck down in front of his kneecap and keep attacking him and you should be able to dodge his punch as long as you're close enough to him. In here, watch out for the archers as well as the guys with the big hammers, trying to do your best to attack from a distance while dodging their attack. Over here, duck down on this platform to take out the guy on the wheels. And just like before, duck down in front of the machine gun firing guy, but just getting close enough so you can stay ducked while continuing to attack him. it's now time to do a rematch against that column boss. Thankfully, with Eric being able to attack straight up, you can sometimes attack the things as soon as they fire out. Staying in the middle of the screen with Eric is a pretty decent strategy, and you'll see that the things that they fire out now, instead of just being two, are actually four beams attached to one another. It'll still take a while, just like we did the first time against the column boss, and then you'll be at the staircase leading down to the rematch against the Princess of Moths. Just like the first time with her, she flies down and able to get a few hits in on her, and then after a few hits of her flying around, she'll transform into her giant moth version of herself. She'll fly straight up, and you can keep attacking her on the right side if you want in order to deal a decent amount of damage. Since Eric can't do the jumping diagonal attack, stay on the far right platform or left platform and just keep attacking the moth overhead. You can also keep attacking over and over again to take out the pollen that he drops while doing so. If he goes for his attack when he comes down to the ground, you can actually use the diagonal hit while Eric's on the ground in order to hit the moth right back into the air. Now it's time for the final stage of the game, going back to England to take out Dracula again. Just like the first time, be very careful and jump off the bridge as it breaks while dealing with all those Medusa heads firing out at you. The second time around in this stage should be a little bit easier while you're trying to make your way through this weird split-up room. Like I said, it's definitely disorienting, but focus on the main area where the platform actually is, and you should be able to make all your jumps. Next up, we're back in that upside down room, so be careful when going across. Take out the axe thrower and then jump onto the staircase to continue on. The glowing spheres on these platforms definitely move double the speed they did during the normal mode, so try to do your best to jump to them quickly so you don't end up getting hit by those spheres. Here we have that very long corridor before our boss battle against Death. Move through quickly and just listen for all the soldiers that are going to keep running at you and just take them out with your single hit. Now it's time for the rematch against Death and all his spinning cards. During this rematch on the expert difficulty, you still have three boss battles to redo, but you also have three fireballs instead of one of them being health. When he throws out the fireballs, you can actually use Eric's special jump to avoid getting hit by the fireballs. And the first rematch we end up selecting is the rematch against the Gargoyle. With the powered up spear, you should be able to take out the gargoyle rather easily, only taking 2 hits to knock him down on each side of the screen, and it takes 4 total before he starts doing the bounce around the top. Once he's taken care of, we go back to Death and take on the next boss battle, which is going to be a rematch against Gear Steamer. As soon as he appears, we're going to keep unleashing our jumping attacks to try to wear him down as quick as possible. It takes about 2 or 3 hits before you can actually just stay on the ground and keep hitting him. Unfortunately, I was unable to hit him with my jump there, but I'm able to easily hit him when he lands and take him out, and then move on to the next rematch. With only 1 card left, it's the rematch against the Golem. We have a good amount of crystals still, so I'm going to use the special sub-weapon to easily hit him from the ground, and as you can see, it only takes a couple of hits to completely get rid of all his health, and we move on to the next part of actually facing Death. Just like the first time against Death, be sure to jump over him when he tries to hover down and slice you with the sickle, and then when he runs to the opposite side of the screen and starts pulling you towards him, walk the opposite direction from him so you can easily jump over the sickle that he throws, and then keep turning back every so often to keep hitting him. Once you take care of him, it's time to go to the next segment, go up the staircase, and face off with Elizabeth Bartley again. Just like the first time, Bartley will summon Medusa for us to fight first. Duck in front of her, and just stand a little bit next to her hand, so that the first move goes right over you, stay ducking to avoid the flamethrower, and then jump up into the air to avoid her tail. Then when she starts lurking towards you, just keep hitting her to try to knock her away a little bit, until she starts the process all over again, starting with that one fireball. Once Medusa's been taken care of, it's time for the rematch against Bartley herself. She'll start off in the center once again, summoning the spheres for you to destroy with each and every attack you give her. However, they move a lot quicker, so you have to be really careful and keep delivering the hits as fast as possible before they all form in the center and actually unleash the attack against you. She definitely seems to have a little bit more health this time around, so it actually takes 2 extra on the end instead of just 1 extra of her sphere moves for you to finally defeat her. What? Once she's finally taken care of, we have the long hallway next to her before we make it to the boss battle against Dracula himself. After he's summoned, watch out for the light beam so you don't get hit when he appears, and just time your attacks correctly so you can take out the flame he throws out while also delivering a hit to his head. Well, even though this is expert mode, this boss battle still seems to be rather easy. For the second battle, just like before, we fight that weird mage again, which actually I found out isn't Dracula, it's actually the witch that summoned Elizabeth Bartley back. Watch out for the charged up laser move they ends up using by going under the real one, as well as jump over the fireballs when they join on the bottom. Once you take care of her, it's time to actually fight the real final form of Dracula. Just like before, we're going to be using our lance attacks in order to keep him stuck against the left wall even when he's firing out his attacks. Every time you hit him, he gets a little bit bigger as you can see, but it's still pretty easy to dodge all the sickles he ends up throwing out at you. When you do enough damage, he'll turn red, and once he does so, you'll have to jump over his arcing flame, or you can actually duck underneath of it if you're close enough to him to avoid getting hit. After enough hits here, he'll turn solid white, and it's time to deplete all his body parts until you actually get rid of him for good. Just be careful that the bones he throws out don't end up hitting you as well. Once we deliver the last hit to Dracula, you can sit back and enjoy the ending, the Castlevania Bloodlines, the version that Eric gets to see. So as you can see, there's Eric's special ending, which really isn't too much different from the ending we saw as John, and then it goes back to the credits. Since I enjoy this song so much, I'm gonna let it play out for a little bit before I do my wrap-up. At the end of the game, you see the copyright again, and then at the bottom, instead of saying try expert mode, it now says, congratulations, you are a master of the vampire killer. Which we were using the Alucard spear as Eric, but either way, that's what you get for completing it on expert mode. It then goes back to the Sega logo, and you can start the game all over again. So with that, that's going to wrap up this edition of Play It Through. I'd like to thank you for watching, and of course, I hope you enjoyed.